Hi, I'm Monica McCain. We're very happy to have the Transportation Committee co-chairs here, Charles Warren and Jonathan Horn. So I'm always calling you just Jonathan. I'm sorry, now I have to learn your last names. Thanks for being here.
Sure.
Let's get started with the first question to help everyone understand what's the purpose and mission of the Transportation Committee.
Well, we really cover everything that has to do with how people get around in the city. And that means we deal with bus issues, we deal with subway issues, we deal with pedestrian issues, we deal with the streets, the bridges, anything else that has to do with the form of transportation. And we see a whole host of issues and problems that come before our committee. I don't
know if Jonathan has. Well, besides the actual transportation, we also are dealing with the infrastructure, the sidewalks, the roadways, the bridges. So like if there's a problem with a sidewalk or somebody wants to dig underneath the sidewalk, that comes to us too, because all of that is covered by the Department of Transportation.
Anything that's covered by the Department of Transportation, we get involved in. Exactly right.
What are the types of activities of the Transportation Committee? You hold meetings, or are there any other efforts that you make towards fulfilling your mission?
Well, you know, we have meetings, and we also go on site visits and look at conditions, and we've gone out and surveyed sort of bus stop areas and, particularly difficult parking problems. And, of course, we, as you indicated, we have our monthly transportation committee meeting, and then we present the resolutions to the full board at the full board meeting.
How does your committee differ from the Second Avenue Subway Task Force? You want to explain why is it separate?
Well, I was when I was the board chair, I created the Second Avenue Subway Task Force because normally it would be something that comes before the Transportation Committee, but it's such a major project in our community, and it has to do with so many things that go beyond transportation, and that's relocation of people and businesses and all kinds of issues like that, that I thought it was important to have a committee that can focus on the subway and its construction and its the ramifications of that construction. And I think it's been a very useful committee, and it's worked very closely with the MTA, New York City Transit, to try and work out problems. And I think it's been helpful because I think the MTA has ended up taking fewer homes and businesses than I think they started out in the beginning, and I think they've tried to work with us to the extent possible.
Exactly what you said, because it really is across, covers not just the transportation issues, there are parks issues with the trees that were being removed in the construction zones, there's housing issues, mm-hmm. there's business issues, there's the Second Avenue Business Owners Association, mm-hmm. which now they're working with to try to help the small businesses up in the 90s that are being devastated by the construction zone. So I think having the dedicated thing was very, very important and very vital. I'm glad Chuck did it, because otherwise we'd be spending all our committee time on that and not getting to any of the other really vital transportation issues in the community.
I think that's a good point, because that would take up probably every meeting a great deal of time on that one issue alone. Mm-hmm. And we have a lot of issues that come before the committee.
Are there other committees of Committee Board 8 that the Transportation Committee works with?
We end up working with a lot of them, actually. Landmarks, Parks Committee, sometimes the Environment Committee. And you really end up interacting with a whole bunch of committees, and we have joint issues. Sometimes we'll have an issue that comes before the Transportation Committee, and we'll get the Parks people there, and it'll be a joint Parks Transportation Committee issue. And sometimes landmarks, we've been doing landmarks just recently on some stuff too.
There's also street life, because the sidewalk cafes, the consent is actually a Department of Transportation consent, which is done through Consumer Affairs. But if an issue comes up with a cafe, it can come to either committee can mm-hmm. actually take action against it. Mm-hmm. Well, we defer to street life, deal with it.
Yes. We have a pretty full agenda at just about at every meeting, because there are so many issues that come before our committee.
It is amazing. What are some of the recent issues that have come up? What issues do the public bring to the committee? What are some of the issues the committee itself brings in to air?
Well, I think one of the major issues that comes before our committee it has to do with parking and traffic issues. And we get, I would say, every agenda we have three or four or more items that deal with parking. And just, you know, at our last agenda, I mean, we have people who want to make no parking zones or no standing zones in front of their buildings. And we have institutions that come and want to have specialized parking in front of their institution. And we have people in the neighborhood that are concerned that we're taking away too much parking and that there should be more on-street parking. And so we get those issues all the time. And we also get issues that have to deal with particularized situations in around someone's street, like 80th Street near East End Avenue. You know, we have problems that come up there. People are concerned about the traffic, and we ought to do something about that. And we try to do something about that. There are a whole host of issues.
One thing that we've been seeing more of lately is people being concerned about safety issues relating to traffic. Mm-hmm. People come to us where there are a lot of accidents occurring in a particular corner, and you know, what can be done in terms of signage, in terms of changing traffic flows to try to avoid that. So that's something that people, I think it's very good. People are being more concerned about not just, you know, that I can't park my car in front of my building, but actually being active in that area. Parking is probably number one. At our last meeting, we had traffic enforcement in to talk about the enforcement of parking regulations, both the under-enforcement and the over-enforcement at times.
Yeah, I think that was really interesting because everybody is always saying, we need more enforcement. Double parking, people who are parking in zones that they shouldn't be in, abuse of permit parking, and you know, there have been a whole bunch of stories, and we've had a lot of hearings about permitted parking, and because around 68th Street, we have a citizen who was outraged by the problem of permit parking and permits that may have been not legal, and we've worked with the 19th Precinct, and of course the mayor has had an initiative to reduce the number of permits that are out there because there are just so many permits. People were shocked to find out the thousands of permits that were given out to all kinds of people in the city. And a permit parker can park anywhere. And I think if you're someone that's running around every day trying to park your car, and you see these people with permits taking up all these spaces, you're going to get angry. And that's what happened with a fellow on 68th Street who's been somewhat of a gadfly, and he's called a lot of things to our attention. And when we think he's right, we want to do something about it. And we've had the inspector Murtaugh, who heads the 19th Precinct. He's been at our meetings a number of times to talk about this whole issue. And people, but my original point was people really want enforcement. And then we had people at our last meeting who say, the enforcement is too much. It's too strict, and they have an interesting problem in the sense that a few years back, this is on 72nd Street, we created a no standing zone because we have a left turn arrow at 72nd and 3rd, and you get the car stopped with the left turn arrow, but in order to keep the traffic flowing, we have a no standing anytime there. And the people who live in that building say whenever they want to drop someone off or pick someone up, there's always a traffic enforcement officer that tickets them just like that. Mm-hmm. And we said to them, wait a minute, you're not supposed to get a ticket if you're just
dropping
off or picking up. And they said, well, we get them anyway. And we had at our last meeting a captain in the traffic enforcement division, and he said he was going to go back and talk to his people and say we've got to do it the right way and give people a chance to pick up and drop off someone. So that's where I think that's where the community board can be really helpful in trying to bring together, say, traffic enforcement and citizens that are having problems and try to get a solution to that.
Yeah. I mean, Chuck, you make the good point in that, a lot of times people tend to feel or whatever, it's that we're in an adversarial relationship with some of the agencies, which is really not what we're there to do. We're there to help the agencies work better and help the residents get their problems solved with the agency in a way that can make everybody happy.
That's because, a great point.
You know, yeah. And in the same, I mean, these residents, take this example, the resident 72nd Street, the person who's driving down 72nd Street and gets stuck behind somebody dropping off a passenger, he wants the ticket written. He wants the car towed, in fact. Mm-hmm. So you've got to make trade-offs and try to make everybody a little bit happy.
Now, that's a great point to show that it's not just passing resolutions, you know, for something, but trying to make the city work.
Well, I think Jonathan is touching on a very important point. My view has always been that when you talk about what is a community board supposed to do, and to me, it's to solve problems for the community, and that's the community at large. And when people come to us, it's because they have a specific problem that affects them in their neighborhood. We have to say, okay, we're going to try to find a solution to that problem, but we also have to see what kind of ramifications that might have throughout the neighborhood and throughout the community board. A lot of times people say, well, we'd like you to change the timing of the light at a particular corner. And we say, well, we have to have the Department of Transportation look at the lights all along the avenue, because if we change the timing of the lights on this street, what does that mean to the traffic flow throughout the whole area? So that's where it's a delicate balancing, and when people come, they're generally really only interested in what their problem is, and they haven't necessarily thought about the wider issues, and we have to do that.
You mentioned you've had representatives from 19th Precinct. Do you have any other experts who come in to participate in the meetings?
Well, we get, mostly we have someone from the Department of Transportation who's there all the time, you know, a fellow who's been very helpful, very cooperative, named Joss Orzik, and he's generally at our meetings, and when we have issues and problems that come up, we ask him to take it back to the Department of Transportation and try to help get a solution. He's very good about following through and working with us on that. We also have the MTA folks who come, because we always have subway and bus issues, particularly bus issues, that come up, and we have to deal with them on those particular problems.
I mean, we've had representatives from Transportation Alternatives come to the meeting to provide their insight, which is, you know, a different perspective. It's also a question that besides the reps or whatever, Commissioner Forgione, who's the DOT commissioner from Manhattan, comes at least once a year, comes to our meeting. We've had higher-level representatives from the MTA come when necessary. As you said, the inspector is there regularly. Representatives from the mayor's office, community affairs office, attend. And all the local electeds. And occasionally they will attend, but usually one of their representatives are there as well.
And they do bring issues to our committee, a number of things. I mean, we've had Dan Gorodnick's office, Jessica Lappin's office bring things, and the other elected officials also bring issues to us.
With this wealth of information that's being generated in these meetings, how to disseminate this information outside of the meeting itself?
I think that's always an issue that you have. Two things that we try to do, and one is obviously put together the minutes of the meeting. And the other thing that we do is we have people that sign up and our sign-in sheets, and we put them on our mailing list, and we try to keep people informed as the same issues come up, and if we need to have them back again, we can notify those people who have been involved in those issues. But I think one of the issues that we've always grappled with at the community board is to how to keep the public in general informed on all these kinds of issues.
Yeah, I mean, I have a personal thing in that we are slowly starting to move into the digital age with our recording of the meetings. The big issue there is, of course, funding. We need funding from somewhere in order to get by the digital recorders to do it. We had hoped to get it from the World President's office. That kind of now is not likely to happen since everybody's budget's being cut. But once we get that, or once we can do it at some point, I'd like to see us actually post the digital file right on our website. So somebody who wasn't able to attend the meeting, more than just read the dry minutes, would be able to actually listen to the meeting and get the full flavor and gist of what went on.
Yes, I think Jonathan's absolutely right. I think that's going to be the future, where we can post things on our website and people will be able to go to the website that you indicated and get the information and follow issues as they come up and as they go through. Because a lot of times things happen and people aren't aware of the history or anything else that's happened, and they have no way of easily getting that information.
And just as a reminder, that's a website, cb8m.com.
Right, exactly.
Next question is actually from one of our viewers, is some of the technical terms that come up in the Transportation Committee are unusual. There was one that was mentioned, Barnes Dance, and the question is, how do you stay on top of these types of terms? And you might want to explain what a Barnes Dance is to the audience.
I think for those who don't remember, there was a famous traffic transportation commissioner, really, here in New York City by the name of Henry Barnes. Mm-hmm. And he'd originally come from Baltimore, and he was very innovative, and he was the one that started the sequential timing of the lights on the avenues. You know, if you go down, except for Park Avenue, but if you, and New York Avenue, if you go down second, third, first, and if you're driving at a certain speed, you hit all the lights. He was the one that started that. And he also actually, I think, made Fifth Avenue one way. It was two ways at one time in the early 60s, or before. Mm-hmm. And the Barnes, what the Barnes dance is, and I think they probably called it that because it's like a square dance. And it, what it means is the lights are stopped at all four corners, and the pedestrians can cross the streets in any direction. And they can cross diagonally to get across. They can cross, you know, from one corner to the other. And it allows pedestrians really freedom to cross in all directions.
We were going to try to get a picture of a Barnes dance or something up on the screen, so I'm not sure if we're able to do that yet. I think we might have something popping up about a kind of a
diagonal cross. That's crossing. What they mean, that you can cross, yeah. You know, diagonally and stuff,
yeah.
Like
so hopefully
that.
That's come up on the screen. We don't get to see monitors when we're doing these interviews, and also a picture of a intersection in Union Square that has that crossing. We have a printout, but it might show up on the screen. I hope it is up on the screen. But how do you stay on top of these types of terms? Because you're not transportation professionals, correct?
That is very correct.
Absolutely.
We have other things that we do. Yes, yeah. We're volunteers. I'm a lawyer, and Jonathan's
an accountant.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so, how do you say? Is it during these meetings you you learn these terms, or do you do any extra research outside of the meetings?
Well, I tend to read everything. I mean everything. So I try to stay on top of the reports that come out from the Metropolitan Transportation, Regional Transportation Authority, the state DOT, things like that, different magazines. And a lot of these terms, more and more, I mean, nowadays, government and politics is really public domain. I mean, with the, you know, with everything, just read the daily newspapers, the blogs, the online. So you get these terms filtering more and more into the daily life. So.
And from my perspective, I'm an environmental lawyer by trade, and when I deal with environmental issues, some of them are transportation issues, and I look at environmental impact statements and things like that always come up. And so over the years, I've acquired a certain knowledge about transportation. Of course, I've also been on the Transportation Committee for some time, and I've chaired it or co-chaired it for quite a while. And so through that process, I've learned a lot about the transportation and some of the technical terms.
And of course, Google is
exactly.
It must be a big resource for you.
Absolutely.
Jonathan is very knowledgeable. I'm impressed by his learning on the subject, even though he hasn't been involved in the committee for that long.
We actually kind of jumping to some of the questions I usually have at the end, which is, how did you get involved in community board work, and how did you get on the transportation committee?
Well, I actually, my community board, my mother was over 40 years ago on the original community, they were called community planning boards at the time, under Mayor Lindsay, and she was appointed to one of those, so I've known about community boards all the way back since then. Back then, of course, they were very political appointments. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was a patronage appointment, but so I knew about it, and when I found that because of my business and other commitments fell through, that I was going to be able to have some more time that I would be able to devote. And Borough President Stringer had made his initiative to revitalize the community boards. I applied and got on. I've been on. I'm coming up for my reappointment this year. Hopefully I'll get it.
And there's three-year terms?
Two-year terms. Transportation committee, I mean, transportation is an issue. I mean, the whole issue, it's, to me, it's the bottom line of everything. I mean, if we can't move people around, it doesn't matter what businesses you have, what, you know, anything else. If people can't get to businesses, people can't get to work, people can't get to school, then everything else falls apart. So to me, it was the first committee when I was appointed. I was asked, what committee do you want to be on? I said, transportation. And I became chair. Fortunately for me, my wonderful predecessor, Barry Schneider, had some other commitments with a bridge centennial that he needed to resign, and the opportunity came there, and I'm very thankful to have gotten it.
Well, I've been on the committee for some time, and I first got interested in the community board because a council member said to me, "How'd you like to be on Community Board 8? And I said, "Well, I don't know much about it, but why not try it?" And so he recommended me for appointment, and I got on, and I saw that it was very interesting, and it was a way to find out what really went on in your community and participate in that in a meaningful way. And I've enjoyed doing it. And I at one point had chaired the Environment Sanitation Committee, and then I got an opportunity to chair the Transportation Committee, and that was, as Jonathan said, I mean, that's so central to everything that happens in a city like New York. I thought that would be an interesting thing to do, and I've been chairing it or co-chairing it on and off for some time.
Do you get a lot of members of the public coming to your meetings? You have people you've mentioned who come with an issue. Do people come in just to listen, who are transportation addicts? Or do you get a big attendance there?
Depends on what's on the agenda. I mean, we've had meetings where we've literally have filled the auditorium at Hunter or at the New York Blood Center where we meet. And we've also had meetings where we've had maybe one member of the public there who is just, you know, visiting, whatever. Mm-hmm. So, you know, when we discuss issues like bus service, bus rapid transit, summer streets, things like that, the major district-wide activities, we get a large attendance.
How about, I think one of our biggest audiences that Jonathan would remember would be about York Avenue and the famous York Avenue traffic study.
Oh,
and that was an issue that people were very excited about. And the Department of Transportation put out a scope for that. And they made a mistake, which they, in hindsight, they wouldn't have done again, I don't think. And they said, one of the things they said in the scope was, well, we're going to consider alternatives like making York Avenue one way.
This is right in front of all the hospitals in these.
Correct. Things,
yeah.
Yeah, it started with the hospitals and the traffic problems in the 60s. You have, you know, Rockefeller University there, and you have New York Hospital, Hospital for Special Surgery, and you have them all in a row there, and Memorial Sloan Kettering. And so there have been tremendous traffic problems. And so we asked the Department of Transportation to, let's do a study. And when they put out this scope for the study, people said, well, they want to make York Avenue one way, and we got a mob there, and the Department of Transportation heard in no uncertain terms that that was something that should never happen ever, and they ended up withdrawing the study, and we then went to look at the issues specifically in front of the hospitals, and one of the things that, you know, we went out, took a look at the did a site visit out there, and we've been working with the hospitals to try to improve the traffic situation in that area, and I think there has been improvement.
Yeah, you know, and as Chuck said, and it's to the hospitals have worked really well with us, and that it's their benefit. They don't want the traffic backed up. It's their patients, it's their workers that are getting stuck in that traffic just as much as the people who are trying to commute through the area.
Exactly.
Well, what do you think are going to be the hot issues coming up in this year? Do you have any idea what's going to be coming in?
Well, I would bet, and we were just talking about this a little before this started, I would bet that the issue of bus service and reduced bus service, because with these budget cuts and the city budget situation, I think you're going to see reduced service you know, with buses and in other areas, and I'm sure we're going to get a lot of complaints in that area. And I know that we'll have a continuation of the traffic issues that we have to deal with, too, and then the parking issues. I'm sure that's something that's...
Yeah, I mean, the parking enforcement issue is going to continue to be large, and I think we're going to start seeing more of what we saw at our last meeting with people coming in with a little bit of over-aggressive enforcement. One of the things is that even at the budget crisis, the city is putting on, I think, 200 or 250 additional traffic enforcement agents. So there's going, I mean, the one side of it is going to be good, and that hopefully some of them will be dedicated to traffic direction and down around the 59th Street Bridge and around the hospitals is an area where we need more agents directing the traffic. But there'll also be more guys out there writing tickets, and I don't want to use the bad word, but obviously there are performance standards which they're going to have to meet.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, some people pejoratively talk about quotas. and I think that's, but I'm sure one of the reasons why they're hiring more traffic enforcement agents is to, there are so many serious problems, and that is one way that, that the city deals with it and incidentally raises revenue.
Yes, yeah. And it's also, it's a good example. I mean, there's been some stories in the press about how the city is getting away from the broken windows theory. This goes the exact opposite way. This is, they're putting more effort into the broken windows. Let's take care of the parking. Let's take care of the traffic violations.
The smaller issues.
Smaller issues.
Smaller crime issues. Well, thank you so much for coming and speaking with us. And it's been great. I hope we'll have you back, get an update on what's going on with the traffic and Second Avenue Subway. Maybe you can speak to that too. So thank you again. And everyone, please come and visit www.cb8m.com and come to some of the meetings, especially transportation.